Let's talk about Suzuki coupling. In Suzuki coupling, we're going to use an organoborane reagent, such as the form we see here, to couple this carbon group that we've got attached to the organoborane to another carbon group that's going to come from a halide of some sort. And let's talk about the limitations on each one of these reagents for the Suzuki. And there aren't that many. This is a pretty versatile reaction. And so what we're going to see is for our organoborane, we're going to be limited to, for sp3 connection here, for an alkyl group to a primary alkyl. So we might have something of this form for our Suzuki reagent here, our organoborane. We also will have a transalkenyl as a possibility, and we'll see why trans is the preferred configuration here in just a few minutes. We also could have a reagent of the form of a aryl or heteroaryl reagent. So a heteroaryl just means there's a nitrogen or an oxygen or some other atom besides carbon in the ring of the aromatic system. We'll just look at a phenyl group here, and we might have something of this form. So a lot of different ways we can put this together for the organoborane side. Now for the halide, we are limited to, again, alkenyl, which would be of this form, all right? Or we could also have an aryl or heteroaryl option for our halide, such as we see here. And so, very versatile. The purpose of using this reagent, this reaction in general, instead of, say, something like a Gilman, is we avoid the finicky nature, the issues with organocuprates. There are, and again, no organolithiums are used during this reaction, you know, so it is a little bit easier to carry out. The reagents are more stable as we are performing this reaction. The one thing that an organocuprate can do that this reaction can't is primary alkyl to primary alkyl reagent. So the Gilman does have its use in that situation, but in modern synthesis, that's a pretty uncommon type situation. So let's talk about a couple of considerations to go with this reaction. We must carry out the reaction in the presence of a base. We just said hydroxide needs to be there in this catalytic cycle. We need the catalyst, so some ligands, you know, there are several common ligands used with this for palladium in this particular oxidation state. And then we need to remember that whatever our alkenyl groups are, they're going to maintain their stereochemistry throughout the reaction. So let's do an example reaction right here to illustrate this. So suppose we have a group such as this alkenyl group, and we are trying to perform the Suzuki on this alkenyl, and we end up with, say, this Suzuki reagent in the presence of the catalyst and hydroxide. And so what we need to notice here is that this is a trans original configuration, and so in the final configuration of our coupled product here, we're going to have this same configuration in the final product. So whichever way we started over here, we're going to maintain that in the product side. Okay, so that's just something to pay attention to. So again, if I had started with, you know, the Z isomer here, the cis isomer, the same reagents, I would have ended up with the phenyl ring. pH again means phenyl, same thing, same two groups, but now I've got the opposite configuration because I started with cis and I ended up with cis on the right-hand side. Okay, maintains that configuration. The extended catalytic cycle is something that you need to check the class notes to see how we're handling that in any given semester. For the time being, we will leave that as a separate issue for now. But we may be asked to make these organoborenes, or you may have to do it one day in your lab. And so how might we go about this? Well, this is just an alkene reaction, just like the first step of hydroboration in an older chapter. And so if we start with an alkene here, and we want to make our Suzuki reagent, well, we're going to react this catechol borane. So this free compound here, if it was a diol, would be catechol, but it's catechol borane. And so we're going to react this to make our primary alkyl Suzuki reagent. And so one of the things that we're noticing here is that, you know, this step is a syn addition, and I've drawn it as such on the right-hand side, but because there's no stereochemistry made, it really doesn't matter for this primary alkyl borane. It does matter in making alkenyl-type Suzuki reagents. So let's have a look at this one. So suppose we took this terminal alkyne, and we performed the same reaction with our catechol borane. This is our line reaction, but let's take a look at this transition state of our intermediate here. So we're going to get together in an anti-Markovnikov fashion, just like we did in alkene reactions. Mechanistically, we are going to perform the same reaction, but this creates a transition state that is a syn transition state. So we've got partial bonds here in the transition state. Because this is a syn addition in this transition state, you're going to end up with your group being pushed down. Our R group gets pushed down away from the addition of the hydrogen that occurs to here, and the borane is going to be syn to that hydrogen, pushing the other hydrogen down on the right hand side. And so you're always going to end up with this trans arrangement when you're preparing the stereospecific to this arrangement when preparing the reagent. Now reacting with an alkene, the alkene can be either form of stereochemistry, but the Suzuki reagent itself is going to remain in this trans form. Okay, the only difference in the preparation is the preparation of an aryl or heteroaryl species. We're actually going to prepare this from an organolithium. So just as a reminder, if we started with a halide, we'd have an excess of lithium in hexane reagents. We would end up with this organometallic complex, and then we would react this with an organoborate, so three groups attached. Remember, boron is sp2 hybridized and violates the octet rule. I know there's some association there with dimers and whatnot, but for the most part we remember that this reagent stoichiometrically is okay with this form because it has a zero formal charge, even though it doesn't have a complete octet. So what does it do? Well, the lithium exchanges with one of the borates, and we end up with our Suzuki reagent. So this will get us ready to go. But two steps involve getting there to the Suzuki reagent when it's an aryl or heteroaryl type reagent. Okay, and let's look at a couple of examples of how the Suzuki might be used here. And so we want to couple this substituted pyridine with the alkene that we see here is the organoborane. We've got our catalyst and hydroxide, so we're ready to go. We're just going to replace that bromine in our heteroaromatic here with the same configuration that we have in our alkene. Couple those together. So we maintain this trans relationship here, goes over to the product. So there is stereochemistry, but nothing changes here. And again, flipping an alkene around, I think we've just flipped this 180 degrees. It doesn't matter for ENZ. Mirror image does not create a new isomer for ENZ type stereochemistry. Now, we're looking at the second example here, we see a couple of stereocenters. The first is a Z arrangement or a cis arrangement. And then in the second, we have an E arrangement or a trans arrangement. So we know the only way to get a trans arrangement, or the only way to get a cis arrangement, is with the halide of our system. So we're going to want to have the halide of the coupling reaction be cis or Z, so that we can then take advantage of the always trans stereochemistry of the Suzuki reagent. And we couple those together to give the product that we see.